Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming out. My name is Joel Tepask. I'm the Programs and Communications Coordinator at Blade of Grass. Thank you for coming. I want to start by thanking our generous hosts, Shelley and Don Rubin. They're providing tonight's venue and the staff here at the 8th floor. The 8th floor is a private exhibition and event space created by Shelley and Donald to promote cultural and philanthropic initiatives. The exhibition you see around you is called Droptomania. It's curated by Alejandro Villafuente and explores the impact of an Afro-Cuban art movement called Grupo Antiano. It's on view until July 18th, but we encourage you to take a look around while you're here. Blade of Grass, which is who's hosting tonight, is the first funding nonprofit that's dedicated solely to nurturing socially engaged art. We fund individual artists and arts organizations that are working directly with communities in ways that are relevant to everyday life at an ambitious scale to enact social change. We also create programs like the one you're at tonight and web content that explores the challenges and opportunities of socially engaged art practice. Before we get going, we have a few announcements. First and foremost, we want to say thank you to everyone who attended Open Engagement this past weekend. We're very proud to co-present the conference this year with the Queens Museum and Social Practice Queens, and we couldn't have done it without your support, so thank you. We taped videos of the keynote presentations by J. Morgan Pewitt and Marilyn Mucleis, and those will be available online soon. Secondly, we're also proud to be working with an amazing group of fellows and grantees this year. Our inaugural group of ABOG Fellows for Socially Engaged Art are Brett Cook, Pablo Helguera, Fran Illich, Noreen Letty and Liz Slagis, Jan Munn, Laurie Jo Reynolds, and Jody Wood. And our org grantees are Arts East New York, The Foundry Theater, and Not an Alternative. We encourage you to sign up on our email list. There's a paper at the front there. Their postcards are there too if you want to learn about their projects. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and stay up to date with everything they're doing, everything ABOG is doing. It's going to be a really exciting year. Also online, we have a new essay in our Fertile Ground online forum. It's by Greg Chalette. It's called Knots, and it explores the question, is socially engaged art always progressive, which was the topic of our last Aesthetics of Doing panel discussion. Tonight's discussion, Parallel Fields Will Work for Food, will ask some similarly politically rich questions. We'll be focusing on labor rights in the restaurant industry. We're thinking about how art and advocacy for workers' rights can be coupled together effectively, the ethics of eating and dining in a restaurant, and asking if artistic strategies can make labor practices better for everyone. We're thrilled to be discussing these issues with our panelists, Daisy Chung and Christina Sanchez-Juarez. Daisy Chung is Executive Director of the Restaurant Opportunity Center of New York, a membership-based worker center organizing for improved conditions for New York City restaurant workers. Chung has also worked on other issues concerning low-wage workers, including advocacy for domestic workers, welfare rights, and prisoners' rights. She is a former restaurant worker and a graduate of CUNY Law School. Christina Sanchez-Juarez is an artist who utilizes performance, community organizing, and popular education to investigate how collectivity and the arts can bring about social change. Her most recent project, Cucina Abierta, is a collaborative nomadic test kitchen that incorporates immigrants' personal histories and culinary skills into the development of a worker-centered philosophy to eating ethically. And with that, I'll hand it over to our moderator for the evening, Elizabeth Grady, who is Programs Director of Blade of Grass.
So welcome, thanks so much for coming out. We have a great opportunity tonight. Because of the size of our group, we can have really more like a group discussion, an informal discussion, instead of sort of the usual panelists up front, and we don't get to ask questions till the end, and all of that. And so what I'd like to do is start out as planned and let Daisy and Christina tell us a little bit about their work. And I'll kind of kick off the discussion, but as you have questions, please feel free to raise your hands, and we'll Joel will help us kind of moderate, kind of pass the mic around a little bit. I know it's a use the mic sometimes, but it really helps people hear, especially, you know, some people don't hear as well as others, and so even if you think you're screaming, sometimes you're not. So try to use the mic if you can, just to be kind to everyone's possible needs. Which of the presentations do we have up? First, we've got Daisy, and so let's hear about Bob.
Okay. Do you guys mind if I expand? All right, so I can actually go up here. Okay, good evening, everyone.
Hi, Dave.
My name is Daisy. So just to give you all a brief background on Rock New York, we are a membership-based organization. We have 5,700 restaurant workers who are part of our organization, and they are restaurant workers across New York City, the five boroughs of New York City. So who are restaurant workers in our great city? There are over 200,000 restaurant workers just in New York City. And across the country, over 10 million individuals work in this industry. And so these 200,000 workers work, you know, they prep, cook, serve food to New York diners every day, right? They keep food service open in New York City 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And they're a really vital part of the New York City economy. And, you know, the reality is that, you know, although the industry employs tons of workers, right, it's, you know, it's workers are struggling within this industry. The reality is that the restaurant industry is one of the nation's worst employers. Low wages, no benefits, little advancement opportunities, legal violations are all, you know, are all characteristics of this industry, unfortunately. And so I could go on and on about statistics, 200,000, no wages, but I really want to share a story of one of our members. His name is Samuel. And Samuel is an immigrant from Mexico, and he worked in restaurants ever since he's immigrated to this country 10 years ago. And so for 3 years, he worked at a restaurant in the financial district, and he worked as a cook. And one day, he came into our offices. He found out about us from another worker in the financial district. You know, a lot of restaurant workers know each other in New York City. Even though there are 200,000, there are networks of workers. And he came to us because of an injury that he had at work. And at work, you know, so he was, you know, I met with him, I sat down with him, and he told me what happened at work, and he was moved, he was told to, you know, by the chef to move a pot of boiling water, right? And, you know, I guess, you know, when I say pot of boiling water, people think of, you know, they're the pot that they use to boil pasta in their home, right? But this is, you know, think of a commercial-sized pot of boiling water, right, that someone is, and that's heavy, right, even a small pot of water. And he was told to move it from the stove, where it was boiling, to another part of the kitchen. And so while he was attempting to do this, he slipped, because the, you know, the floor was wet and slippery, and he slipped, and the water from the pot fell on half of his body. And so, you know, he went to the emergency room, but he came to us, he's like, what do I do with my bills? Like, what do I do with my hospital bills? I went to the ER, and they fired him because he could no longer work at that point. He had nerve damage. And, you know, I asked him, you know, did they ever ask you to fill out a workers' compensation form? And he was like, what is that? What's workers' compensation? And so the minute that he said this, right, so there's like all these flags going up, and I'm like, okay, wait a minute, let's talk about, you know, what your other working conditions were like. And so he wasn't paid overtime. He worked 12-hour days, 6 days a week, never got a penny of overtime during the 3 years that he worked for this restaurant. He actually told us about deposit that he had to make at this restaurant. And the deposit was because he was an immigrant, and so it was a security for the employer in case he was deported. And so, you know, this is Samuel's story, but unfortunately it's the norm in the industry, and I don't wanna belittle his story and his personal experience, but it's the experiences of so many people within this industry. And you know, this is part of restaurant culture that doesn't get airtime, right? You know, we get, you know, on TV shows, you know, of like exciting moments in the kitchen of you know, hot shot chefs. And so over the last, you know, so it's like kind of, why is this happening, right? Why is this happening in such a booming industry? And over the last several decades, the restaurant industry has seen growth. So that's the next slide. And so, you know, if you look, you know, over the last several decades, you know, the industry in terms of sales has skyrocketed into billions, hundreds of billions of dollars in sales over the last few decades. And, you know, so with rising profits, there's been also a rising power and influence. And that with that power and influence, the industry is telling a very different story about the sector and what workers are experiencing on the ground. And so, you know, the industry is organized by a group called the National Restaurant Association, right? And which we call kind of the other NRA. And you know, it's big corporations that are playing very, very key roles in shaping industry practices, right? That are hurting not just workers, but it's hurting their families and our economy. And so since 1998, the NRA has spent $26.5 million lobbying our federal government to prevent raises, you know, increases in standards, in better standards for workers. Not just for this sector, but for the low-wage sector. And so in order to go up against, right, these very powerful allies that have millions of dollars to pour into lobbying, restaurant workers obviously need allies, right? Restaurant workers can't win the changes that are needed within this industry without allies. And, you know, and our society, frankly, won't demand change, right, unless people understand what restaurant workers are going through, right? And understanding that they are people like them, right? Like them, and going through you know, the same challenges of raising families and getting by, particularly in a city like ours. So in order to create this, right, this popular front, this movement of people that want to see change in this industry, we need to really tap into the consumer base. There are very few people who are left untouched by this industry, right? And I'm sure like everybody here has gone out to eat. I know like almost every day I'm at even like a deli getting coffee or a sandwich for lunch. And you know, it's a part of our way of life. And actually 75% of people in the US go out to eat at least once a week. 75% of us, and 40% of our food dollars actually go into eating outside of the home. So there's a tremendous power that consumers have right now, because this is our culture and our way of life. And what we've been doing is really using media and cultural projects to help both educate consumers and also move them into action, right? So that, you know, they see restaurant workers not as these invisible hands that you know, all of a sudden they make your food appear right at your table, but that they're people like them, that they're mothers and fathers, and that they're young and old, and you know, all of the things, right, that make up our diverse society. So I just kind of want to share a video that our members were part of.
The best things need some money. That's
what I want. Necesito dinero.
You want to run a successful restaurant in New York City?
You've got to treat your workers right.
Tell Albany to pass a minimum wage hike of at least $9 this March.
And to raise it when needed to match the cost of living.
It's the right thing to do. Because your workers don't just want more money.
They need it.
So obviously, you know, media alone is not going to be enough, right, to change a lot of the conditions that restaurant workers are experiencing. But consumers are really, you know, are really critical, right, to educating other consumers, right, and really moving them into action in those, you know, in disseminating information. And so what we've done at Rock New York was really thinking about, like, how can consumers partner with us, right, in creating change within this industry. And so what we've done is partner with different consumers, right? And consumers are really everyone. Everyone are, you know, we're all consumers in the industry. But really thinking about, like, which consumers have audiences, right, that we can tap and that we can access and that we can disseminate this type of information to. And so we have a group called the High Road Roundtable, where we engage different consumers, right? So they're bloggers, radio hosts, they're academics, they're different institutions. You know, so for example, culinary institutions like the James Beard Foundation and City Tech. You know, they have a culinary arts program. And really thinking about how do we get this message out, right? Not just to workers, but to people all across our city. And so, I'll kind of open it there. But this is just our members at a march. And thank you.
Before turning it over to Christina, I just want to make clear kind of the format of this program. Parallel Fields is a program where we bring together an artist who works in a specific area, in this case dealing with workers, restaurant workers' rights and the issues of working conditions, and somebody who works professionally in the field in some way. So sometimes it's about the environment, sometimes it's about legal questions, sometimes it's about finance and debt servicing, and tonight it's about restaurant workers' rights, right? And so the reason that we have Daisy and Christina here together is because they come at the same issue from these different perspectives, one through the lens of art and one through the lens of organizing and activism.
Thank you. I'm going to drive over here. So, deep breath. Okay. So my name is Christina Sanchez-Juarez. I'm the child of Mexican immigrants, Rosalina and Guadalupe Sanchez, who were born into poverty and raised in a small rancho in Jalisco's northernmost mountain. Most of my family, my dad and my mother's brothers and sisters, migrated to the U.S. in the late 1970s. But really their paths were charted by my abuelos, or my grandfathers, who made their first trips to the USA beginning in 1948. Both of my abuelos participated in the Bracero program and worked in agriculture all over our country. However, they also crossed without permission when it was necessary. My abuelo, que en paz descanse, tells the story of getting caught by La Migra and having his head shaved by Border Patrol agents. They justified this action by saying that it helped them detect repeat offenders who were attempting to cross the border. You were marked. In California, where I live, work, and make art for social change, we just passed a driver's license bill for undocumented immigrants. The licenses are supposed to be ready in January of next year.
Only thing is that there's a slight stipulation in the bill which says that the licenses must be marked in some way to indicate that the person who possesses it is undocumented, or rather, they cannot access any federal or state benefits. So our undocumented brothers and sisters are still being marked. My family migrated to the States when, statistically speaking, immigrants still had a slight chance of obtaining financial stability and perhaps even citizenship. After working in the tomato fields of Northern California for many years, my father landed a job with a rice mill, which is owned by Budweiser, or Anheuser-Busch. He worked there for 30 years. It wasn't a glamorous job, but it was a good job. My father loves to remind me that he was in a union. He had a growing pension, a house, two kids, and health insurance for the whole family by the time he was 25 and only had a sixth grade education. Fast forward to 1998. On the left is Caetano, an immigrant from Oaxaca, Mexico. And on the right is David from Mexico City. Caetano also stopped going to school after the sixth grade so that he could dedicate his time to working to help feed his family. He crossed over in 97 and has worked in California restaurants ever since. David on the left is from Mexico City, but he left shortly after the recession, after months of being able to find stable work. Caetano has worked in 15 different restaurants since migrating in 1997. Never making more than $12 an hour, but for the most part hovering around 10 bucks an hour for all these years. He's never had health insurance or a single paid sick day. He's worked on countless occasions, not because he thinks it's okay, but out of necessity and fear of being fired. Prior to the recession, he had two jobs, which he worked 7 days a week, with most of his money going to rent or to his family back home in Mexico. Caetano, the one on the left, is my husband and my main collaborator. All of the work that I'm going to show you has been made in conjunction with him. More recently, we began formally working in collaboration with another amazing wine cook named Oakland Bautista, who's here with us tonight. I tell you all of this to give you a glimpse into the history and the politics that have shaped me. So these are some of the questions that guide my practice. How do artists build honest and reciprocal relationships with community members? And what I mean by community members are who the community member is. That's always kind of shifting. Sometimes it's a non-artist, sometimes it's a restaurant worker, sometimes it's other organizers, a mother in the community, children in the community. And how do you keep these relationships reciprocal and honest and really transparent about what you're trying to do? These are members of Rock LA, which is the organization that I started volunteering with in 2011. And Daisy did a great job of giving you kind of like a national picture of what restaurant working conditions are like. I want to talk a little bit about the specific LA context in a little bit. This is another question. Can the embodiment of another person's words or actions lead to the production of empathy? So in the beginning, the project, which is called the Great Balsa Project, was really kind of centered around re-performing workers' words, re-performing worker actions. How can we work collaboratively to create culinary experiences that allow workers to experience autonomy outside of the workplace, experiences that give creative license, experiences and experiments that acknowledge their skills and crafts? And I'll talk more about what that kind of looks like. An image of two of our collaborators, Caetano, my husband, and Ariel Torres. So, Los Angeles is home of the largest restaurant industry in the nation. We also have the distinction of being the wage theft capital of the United States. And according to a UCLA labor study, there were higher rates of wage theft in Los Angeles than in New York and Chicago combined. Wage theft disproportionately affects low-wage workers in various sectors, such as the garment industry, construction workers, and of course, restaurant workers. The focus of my work is on a specific type of restaurant worker, the back-of-house worker. So they are the line cooks, prep cooks, dishwashers, and of course, the bussers who move back and forth between the front and the house to maintain our restaurants and prepare our meals. In Los Angeles, most of the back of house and front of house positions are essentially segregated. Workers of color are overrepresented in lower paying back of house positions. So to begin the Break Bowser project, what we did is we started off by getting to know restaurant workers in Los Angeles through Rock LA primarily. We started interviewing, Cortana and I started interviewing restaurant workers both informally at cafes. We would make appointments with them. We would, And then we also conducted these bus stop interventions where we set up tea and candy and we kind of scoped out corners where corners or bus really busy intersections that were close to restaurants and started to just talk to people. We had a small recorder, we'd ask people for permission to record stories and ask them basic questions about what their days were like. After kind of amassing these restaurant worker stories, it was time to decide what we were going to do with them. And the first thing that we did was we made a script. I don't know if that came from living and working around Hollywood. It became the script. It was not a linear or really a narrative script, but it had all these fragments of these restaurant worker stories. The saute pan hit the back of the broiler and flew back at me. The whole pan, fish, and boiling oil fell on my arm. So we had the script, and then we started taking it out into different community college settings and re-performing, doing cold reads of the script and performing worker words and also worker actions. So we also started amassing all these restaurant worker, we call them props, but they're not really props, you know, they're things that people use every single day in the restaurant business. And then we also started to more directly involve restaurant workers in telling their testimonials after the performances. So we have everybody participating in re-speaking workers' words, and then we ask a restaurant worker, in this case Caetano, to talk about his experiences, and then we also feature one of this restaurant worker's meals or dishes that they had created. Here's the script in a protest context performed by other Rock LA members. And then we also kind of had, we had a more formal, in the gallery, in the white cube, presentation of the work. The script then became the score, and there, you can see it right here, but on the left there were directions for the score about how you could embody restaurant worker actions like scrubbing a pot 50 times, putting on a uniform, and then there was a small stage where you would proceed to speak a sentence or two that a worker had had said to us and that we had then transcribed in English. While you're saying this, there was this audio of the score of restaurant worker stories in their own words playing over your re-performance or re-telling their words. So these are different community college students groups that have came into the space. This is one iteration of the performance where we got to actually go to a culinary school and perform for culinary students. So the performer is learning on the table there, and culinary students, it's hard to tell the difference between the performers and the culinary students are the ones that are sitting at the tables. It's Natasha Rose, Rock Along member and now performer, performing parts of the score. In 2012, we did this project called Living Wage, where we were invited to politicize a dinner at a very posh gallery. What we asked is that the workers that were brought in to cater the meal, if they could please have a Los Angeles living wage. And at the time, the living wage was $20.89. So they were paid to conceptualize the meal, and they were also paid for their actual labor. So. It's very rare where people are paid for their thinking time in this industry. So that was really pretty special. Shots of Kaye and Ariel both worked on this meal. And then now the new kind of initiative of the project is called Cocina Abierta, so open kitchen. So I'll just read a little bit about what Cocina Abierta is. So Cocina Abierta is a nomadic experimental test kitchen that facilitates the fluid exchange of immigrant histories, culinary skills, and basic building strategies towards the development of a worker-centered philosophy to aiding ethically. Just as a traditional test kitchen functions as a laboratory for the creation of new dishes, Cocina Abierta serves as a space of experimentation where we test the limits of interpersonal boundaries, such as those that exist between foodies and low-wage workers, culinary graduates, and fast food workers and back of house and front of house workers. So what we're doing is we're bringing cooking really back into the mix and really using that as the vehicle with which we interface with the public. So this is really the work that's in progress right now. We have kind of two different parts of the project. One part of it is developing classes for back of house workers that are actually taught by restaurant workers that don't necessarily have any kind of like culinary degree, but they have a ton of experience. And then also providing classes for consumers and then trying to see how we can get those two people into the same room. So this is one of our public cooking demonstrations where Oakland and Kaye are cooking and then also talking about their experiences as restaurant workers and also providing knowledge, right, for the public. And these are some images of our event at Open Engagement just a couple of days ago. So we were invited to Immigrant Movement International, which is a space that's run through the Queens Museum. It's an immigrant community center. And we were invited to engage the public there and also conference participants. And what we did was we organized a cooking demonstration with three delicious, recipes. And then we had everybody do everything communally, so make all the food together. Here are some images from that event. So we all made the food together, and we proceeded to have a barbecue, and then we ended with stories from restaurant workers, and then asked for reflections on the experience. And then I'll just end by talking a little bit about these things called home visits. So we're beginning to have these classes and we're doing these public cooking demonstrations. And then the other part of it is also acknowledging home cooks and looking at how we can find ways for line cooks and home cooks to collaborate and exchange knowledge. Because usually you work in a restaurant, you have one person that really gives one kind of lead chef person maybe that really gives you, that dishes out knowledge and teaches you how to make your dishes. But then we're like, how do we move beyond that and also respect and acknowledge our home cooks and the home cooks in our community. So Kaye and I visited four different home cooks this past March, and they showed us how to make some delicious food, and now we're in the process of disseminating their recipes back out to the public. So these are just some images from that restaurant.
And I think I'll end there. Thank you.
So one of the things that's kind of embedded in the work that both of you do is the question of ethics. And I'm interested to hear a little bit about what eating ethically means to each of you, because you're both, you know, there's this sort of this rupture between the worker experience and the end user experience, the customer experience, right? So I'm interested to hear, you know, like sort of solutions if people want to help out, but they can't devote themselves to volunteering and activism and whatever, if they have their own busy lives, how do they do something? So what does eating ethically mean to you, and how do you encourage people to do it?
Sure.
Sure.
So eating ethically, I think that's a term that's pretty fluid at this moment, you know, and I think a lot of people are trying to define this concept. I mean, for us, right, in a very labor-oriented, right, we're coming at it from a very, you know, from a labor orientation. And for us, it's based on, right, the research, right, the experiences of our members, right, of what they feel are serious problems within the industry, right, that really, that inhibit their abilities to live, right, their lives with dignity and respect. And so I think, you know, in very concrete terms, right, what we've been doing is working with employers. So we actually engage with employers across the city and really develop, right, from our perspective about what workers are telling us and based on, you know, research, right, that we've done on this industry. And really coming up with, well, what are the areas, right? What are, in very broad strokes, what are the areas that really need improvement within this industry? And so it really goes across around wages. Wages are extremely low within this industry. You know, as you saw in the video, right? You know, 60% of restaurant workers earn poverty wages, and 80% actually earn low wages, right? So that's below a living wage. And then benefits are something that, like, I mean, even having like a paid day off, right, is virtually non-existent within this industry, but also includes things like health benefits, right, or a 401k or a pension, right, like, you know, different benefits that are, you know, might be normal in other industries. And then advancement opportunities. Right? So, you know, in this industry, it's, you know, sometimes people will be dishwashers for 10 years and never have the opportunity or the access to a higher paying job. So those are like the three areas. And in terms of benefits, we also look at health, right, and whether, you know, there are good health and safety standards within a restaurant. So those are kind of the three areas that we look at. And employers, right, the employers that we partner with, you know, kind of help develop that and shape that and see, like, okay, what are ways in which, you know, we can make these things a reality within the industry, right? So it's also recognizing, well, there's also challenges, right, of saying, well, this is the norm and everybody is just doing it because it's like, well, if you don't do this, then, you know, you're in the back of the line, right? Or you're not even going to succeed, right? Because there's, you know, if one person is paying $20 an hour and the restaurant next door is paying, you know, $7.25, right? There's issues of competitiveness as well. So, you know, how the way that we see consumers being engaged in this is really learning about our high-road program, right? And this is kind of our engagement with employers and how consumers, right, can encourage those practices, right? By whether it's patronizing these businesses, but also, you know, setting up spaces for dialogue, right, with their family and friends. And so we do things, we've been calling them eat ups, and they've gone through various evolutionary stages, but you know, we're calling them eat ups right now, where we, you know, host these dialogues with consumers, right? And our members are involved, our workers are at the table, but also the employers, right? They come and engage in dialogue with consumers about why this is critically important and why we need the participation of all these different stakeholders in order for change to happen. So.
In LA we have a similar model with a high-road roundtable of restaurants that are trying to be at the table with Grok and think about paid sick days, to think about higher wages, and so on. So Oakland and Caetano actually work at one of these high-road restaurants. It's called Good Girl Dinette. It's in Los Angeles in Highland Park. And for us, it's been, personally for me and Caetano, it's been the first, you know, it's been the first time that he's ever worked at a restaurant that that provides slightly higher wages, that's compassionate about taking a day off, that has employs these kinds of philosophies, really. And then for me personally, I feel like I'm still trying to define what eating ethically means to me, but in my heart and in my bones, I think it's a lot about really, it's about acknowledgement. It's about building relationships with the people that you see constantly at restaurants. It's about asking questions, and remembering to make eye contact. And I've caught myself like forgetting to look at the barista. You know, those kinds of things. I think that. If we were to really slow our bodies down and look at the people who provide these services for us, then that will help us to begin to ask more questions.
I'm interested, too, in the way that each of you use art to talk about these issues, because, you know, it'd be easy enough to go straight to activism, right? And just say, okay, well, let's just, you know, pick it outside of McDonald's, and you know, a lot of these things are happening in the world right now. So, you know, Christina, how did you come to this issue through your practice, and how did you decide to use art as a lens through which to address this issue that's important to you? And Daisy, I know that you've done some work with restaurant workers producing creative projects in the video that you showed, and sort of, you know, why that strategy, you know, why not a more straightforward strategy or a more expected strategy, I guess you could say, you know, the tried and true, so to speak.
I don't know why the why art question is always so difficult for me. Why art? Because I've been an artist my whole life. I know that's not good enough. In my 20s, I was and still am a teaching artist before I went back to school and did the whole MFA thing. I worked as an elementary school teacher for communities of color. I always made artwork about immigrant rights issues when I was a 2D artist and in printmaking and painting about these issues. And then, honestly, I started to hear about this thing called social practice. I learned about Suzanne Lacy's practice. And I really finally got permission. I think I started to tap into look at these different practices, and somebody gave me permission to then like go the next step beyond strictly a visual representation of what I thought these issues were or how I thought these issues were affecting people's lives. I'm also really interested in, I'm really interested in providing experiences for people who don't have access to like the kind of institution that we're sitting in right now. Just really trying to continually work with different kinds of folks that aren't necessarily artists. I mean, that's really what drives me, and working together to think of how we can really push art forms. It's a hard question. It's really fine.
So in terms of, you know, Rock New York engaging our members and restaurant workers in creating different, you know, art, you know, creating media, I think it has, you know, two goals, right? Or maybe not, they're not maybe goals, because it's not really explicit. It's more about, they're two kind of outcomes. Right, through that process. One, it's extremely therapeutic for people who engage in these projects, right? So a lot of times we talk about things that are taboo or are just very difficult for people to just, hey, like, why don't you stand there? We'll record you telling your story. And a lot of people don't want to do that, right? So for example, in our Gender Justice Committee, the way that a lot of members feel comfortable talking about sexual harassment or being an LGBTQ worker in the industry is through art, right? So one of the projects that we've done, because it was a very hard issue for a lot of workers to talk about in a very direct way, we started photo project with our members, where members took photos of each other, right? So they were like, tell me what you want to portray about your experience, right, to this other worker. So it was very much like a peer-to-peer project. So I mean, we just kind of termed it, we don't even know if this term exists, but we've called it participatory art making within our organization, just internally. But we don't know if that's a term or a real phrase. But really thinking about, like, well, how do we actually involve members in not just telling the story, but actually shaping that story and having agency in how that story is told to the public. And so that's a really important thing to us, right, as an organization. And then on the other end, I think, sometimes when you do talk very directly about things like discrimination, people's reactions, right? You don't necessarily always get positive reactions from an audience, right? When you're very direct about these issues. And so when people, you know, sometimes when people can be in a space and be surrounded, right? When we did this photo exhibit, just be surrounded by photos that address these issues without being like talked at about it, I think sometimes can be much more effective, right? In really helping people understand what workers are going through and what people like them are going through. So those are kind of like the two goals of art and media within
art. I mean, for me, I was fortunate enough to be able to be there for Christina's and Oakland's presentation at Open Engagement on Sunday morning. And for me, it was an opportunity to engage people that I otherwise would be unlikely to encounter in my daily, you know, existence. I don't go into the kitchens of restaurants and you know, introduce myself to the dishwasher, right? I mean, that's not a normal thing to do. In fact, there's probably something illegal about it based on health code or something, because I'm not, you know, properly trained and all that stuff. You know, for me, I think that the art, that what art does is it provides an opportunity for a kind of a non-threatening way to encounter one another and have conversation. And that's what I thought was so powerful. I mean, and, you know, what we did Sunday morning was was a bunch of people who didn't know each other who got together and just cooked a meal. And we had, you know, guidance and instruction from, you know, from a professional. And we had some help with translation, right? There were Spanish-English interpreters to help people communicate if they didn't all speak the same language. And what happened was people started to talk to each other. There were some key questions that were asked at the beginning to engage people in dialogue about kind of who they were as individuals and how they saw their relationship to food. Real general questions that anybody anywhere could answer, right? And it was really powerful. I have to say, and that's I think the key. You know, it's moving things into a space where it's not threatening, and it's moving people into a space where they can talk to each other comfortably, even if they wouldn't necessarily, you know, normally encounter one another socially. At this point, I think I'd like to, you know, to open it up and see if all of you have any questions. Usually, we wind up having like 3 or 4 questions of these things, and I think it would be great if we could have more of an interactive moment since we have this wonderful intimacy this evening. So, if anybody has any questions,
this is one.
I'd like to hear about how both of you do evaluation in your programs and what artistic forms of that self-evaluation you do, and also if you use traditional forms of evaluation that corporations or funders would like to see, whether you create your own and what they might be, and whether you work with traditional forms as well.
From an artist standpoint, let's see. I'm going to be totally frank. I just recently gotten into a position where I've been lucky enough to start acquiring funding for my projects. So I'm about to encounter those moments of figuring out how to do a lab evaluation. But one thing I will say is that if you choose to collaborate with these kinds of organizations, it's all about showing up and showing up and showing up and showing up. And I feel like my measure of evaluation for myself and for Cayetano has really been in the depth of the relationships that we've been able to establish with different restaurant workers, such as Oakland, such as Ariel Torres, who's another wine group that we've worked with, and being able to have, we say in Spanish, the confianza, or the trust, to call on each other, to come together, to organize these events, and to really be there for each other. So I think that's where we are right now. But eventually, we will have to have more formal relationships.
So I think kind of related to, I mean, this is kind of an evaluative tool that we use for different programs, and not just when we do different art projects, but you know, for us, one thing that's really important that comes out of any project that workers participate in is leadership development, right? So really looking at, okay, how many workers engaged in this project, and out of those workers that engage in this project, how many actually end up, you know, being part of our speakers bureau, right? How many end up, you know, becoming leaders within the various committees? So we have different worker committees. So it's really measuring, you know, their leadership level and whether that actually helps them get to a different place within the organization. And so that's something that we always constantly, you know, measure. It's not, you know, it's not a very easily quantifiable outcome, but you know, we measure about, you know, way, you know, this is the progression, right, that we see our leaders within the organization. And so really kind of going through those steps. And then also on the other end is if we produce media pieces and art pieces, well, how many people are being reached, right? I think that's a really important thing, right? So if we had this video that, you know, so many members poured a lot of hours, you know, into creating, you know, well, if 5 people saw it, you know, we definitely wouldn't see that as a success, right? But this video was actually very strategic. It was at a moment in the campaign you know, where it was, you know, kind of at the last leg of the campaign when we released it. And, you know, our goal was within 2 weeks, we need to get 20,000 viewers, right? And we did. We actually exceeded our goal in terms of viewership for this video. So, you know, reach is really important to us. We want the things that, you know, the projects that our members create, it's getting out there. We want to make sure of that.
That wasn't fabulous video. I guess I have a bunch of questions, so I'll try and figure out either way to connect them or separate them out. But one thing that I was thinking about, and I guess it was spurred by your question, is, you know, what do artists who come to these projects do perhaps differently than would otherwise occur in an activist set of goals and ways of working? And so I was thinking about, on the one hand, you know, like the aesthetics of the projects and how, you know, the skills that you bring as an artist from training over the years or because of the way you work impacts how you actually create the environment where these gatherings take place, or the way in which you use your understanding of, you know, on a material level or in signage or orchestration of space. Like, how does that factor in to the way you organize events? So that's one question. And then I couldn't help but, Christina, because of your introduction about your own family history, I kept thinking about the link between, you know, because the other thing I think artists do really well is make visible systems that are otherwise seen as autonomous. And so because of your family history with, you know, agricultural work, I was thinking, like, has there been a conversation between the labor in restaurants and the labor on farms, which is so obviously a link in terms of how we get what we're eating? So both of those things are things I'd just love to hear more about.
I mean, I feel like, for example, just even real simply, just at the open engagement thing, like what do I bring as an artist? Oakland came up with three recipes, right? One of them had tapatio in it somehow. Another one had a fish sauce, a squid brand fish sauce, and then the last one was a chimichurri recipe that was based with obviously a lot of garlic in it, right? So I was like, you know, the first thing I went to is, I go to images. Sometimes I don't want to accept that, but that's where I go, right? So I ended up producing a drawing of a tapatio dude in the typical sombrero, and we had a squid brand fish sauce, the logo was reproduced, and then we had some cloves of garlic, and then each one of the teens then had an image for them. And it was a fun, kind of playful way for people to also build kind of camaraderie around amongst themselves and a little bit of competition too for each one of the teams. And then I always, since I love performance and I really feel like I come from performance, I always think about the way that the room is going to be laid out, the way that people are going to be able to move, for example, there around the tables, the way that they're going to be, it's really choreography, really in position. Yeah, in relationship to each other, moments of like silence versus moments of like frenetic energy. Yeah, those are things that I'm always thinking about as an artist. I'm sorry, what was your second?
Well, you're about the farm workers.
About the farm, I feel tied ancestrally to food and to food. Labor. I've been really, really focused on restaurant workers since 2011 specifically, but I know that's part of where it comes from. To food labor and to low wage labor. You know, my mom's worked in a dollar store for the past like 10 years and has also made around 10 bucks, or has gone up to about 10 bucks an hour all of this time, and to think about that, just to think about that, and no compensation for cost of living as that goes up.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I have to say that the choreography worked very well on Sunday morning. The pictures really did. They gave the team an identity. There wasn't necessarily a shared identity in the team, and not even where you might expect it. I mean, there were, English speakers from very different places and walks of life. There were Spanish speakers from very different places and walks of life, right? And so that was. To have that image and that idea that, okay, this is our table and this is our space was actually very important in creating like a means of communication. And the other thing that was really interesting is that the way that the tables were arranged, they were sort of centrally arranged around the cleaning area, and you had to encounter the other teams. I mean, there was like one big like laundry sink type thing to clean up all the mess, right? And everybody, I also thought it was really nice how people sort of took responsibility for cleanup. You know, it wasn't like, oh, that's somebody else's problem. Everybody just assumed it was their problem, which was kind of something you don't see all the time. But that created moments of encounter that could have been cooperative and could have been competitive. And in my experience, they were largely cooperative rather than competitive. People didn't sort of go at loggerheads like they could have. You know, it wasn't like we're going to cook ours fastest. You know, that didn't really happen. But that choreography was in fact very important in creating the opportunity for communication.
So this question I'm going to make comes in part from knowing Christina and Glenn, but I was wondering, I've heard you in the time that you've been working in collaboration with restaurant workers also speak about both how you've begun maybe learning a little bit about their knowledge of cooking, and I also feel like I've just heard stories a little bit about how there's your kind of aesthetic or arts training also being shared with Caetano and Oakland. And I found those moments really beautiful, and I was wondering if you could share some of that, and maybe Oakland also wanted to share some of those moments of kind of, because it's very clearly defined, like, whose roles are what, right? Obviously, like, Oakland and Caetano are in charge of coming up with the recipes and sharing that knowledge and you're creating the experience. But I think there's moments when those roles maybe switch a little bit, and if you could talk about that.
For me this time around, I was really happy because Caio wasn't with us, so I had to, I have to bring it and I have to learn from them. For me a big part of the project is really about acknowledgement and acknowledgement of these amazing skills that these the restaurant workers such as Oakland and Caetano have gained through sheer experience and through so many years of cooking. And obviously I learned from them in the process of working on these projects together, but I really want to participate in creating moments like that for other people. Do you want to chat? Can I put you a little bit on the spot? Like, maybe just thinking about along the same lines, it's just like, what has it been like for you to work in this way?
Well, it's been a new experience for me. I haven't been used to social practice. This is something that I've been learning about a lot from Christina. She's given me books to read and things to help me sort of learn the fundamentals in the language. I think for me, a lot of this comes back to dialoguing between people that have those experiences and that have lived through them, and talking to people that don't know anything about them at all. I think that people tend to empathize with something once they understand it, and for me that's an important part in my role in activism in the restaurant industry for the last few years, has been simply to get people to learn and understand what it's really like, and what some of the issues are, what the problems facing workers are, and the kind of things that they're dealing with in their lives and in their work situations. So, for me, that's always kind of the focus. I just want people to listen. I just want them to understand. And I think everything grows out of that. And it's difficult for people to see a situation in which somebody is suffering, or maybe isn't, their life isn't being fulfilled in ways that they deserve, to simply ignore that. So I just want people to see and to understand and to empathize with workers.
The preparation and presentation of food has always been sort of, entered the artistic practice centuries ago. And probably nowadays it's like becoming again very artsy production, and some of the very big chefs are reaching status of the artists. And I wonder if you were able to engage them, if they would be the ones who would speak for the people who really work for them, without whom they would not be able to serve the food they are serving, and the owners would not be able to have the restaurants and incomes they have. So is there like this ability or something you really got engaged with, getting some of these famous names which I hear about on NPR into the fold and have them work?
Definitely. And that's what our High Road program is all about, right? And it's really, really identifying like who has power, right, in this situation, in the society that we live in at this moment, right? Who has the power of controlling the environment, right, in which workers work? And it's chefs, right? It's chefs, it's employers of restaurants, and we have been thinking about, well, how do we reach, right, the chefs all across the city, right, that are, well known and well respected, famous on TV, and really thinking about, the influence that they can carry. But I think the challenge right now is how do we make them pay attention, right, to this issue, right? And I think that's where consumers are so key, right? It's kind of like, okay, which comes first, the chicken or the egg, right? But it's really about, so consumers have really forced this industry to really look at their practices outside of labor, right? So the local organic movement to healthy, right, healthy menus, like McDonald's has salads now, right? Salads, right? So, we're really trying to figure out ways in which we can get the industry to pay attention. And so we're actually working with chefs. So part of our roundtable, our High Road program, we have Tom Colicchio of Craft Restaurants, who's part of the High Road. We have Daniel Myers of Union Square Hospitality Group. And then we also have some local chefs who are pretty famous, the chef at One in My Land, which is, kind of known as the most romantic restaurant in New York. And so we've gotten a lot of attention from folks, but it's like, how do we make this bigger, right? And how do we get more people to this? And I think that's where a lot of the institutions, can help leverage that as well.
It's really, with the High Road restaurants, it's really a two-way street. So we are currently in, Kaya and Oakland work at the Girl by Net, it's owned by G-Trans. It's very much kind of a locally well-known chef. And she is going to allow us to teach these classes, because in In LA, we don't have any workplace training classes for back of house workers, so that's really kind of where we are looking to experiment and kind of pilot some of that work. So again, she's really well known. The classes are going to be held there. She's also respected. Her ethics are really respected. So it's yeah.
I think we have time for maybe one or two more questions.
Hello. First of all, thank you for sharing your experience. I wanted to hear more about what you have encountered when it comes to teaching in the terms of language. For example, the Spanish seems like the most common language we have that exists inside the kitchen. But as you know, there's other different people from different countries dealing in the same space. That just includes everyday kitchen life. It's very harsh and very intense. And then how it goes into the projects or for the organization? How do you work with different language barriers?
So for us, when we first started working with the project, our primary target, because of the language that we dominate is Spanish and English. So we did most of our interviewing with Spanish-speaking immigrants. And then last year, we partnered with a people of color theater called Tiara Productions, and we started doing more interviews with Southeast Asian community members. And that's really where we've kind of had our first foray into kind of hearing these stories and then having them translated back to us and then putting them back into the public in English or in both languages.
Yeah, it is probably the single most challenging part of and you just think of New York and its incredible diversity, the single largest group in terms of languages is Spanish, right, in New York City. But the second group is actually Asian workers, and then it's like, okay, they don't share like a language, right, in terms of a common language. So that's really challenging too, right, when you're like, okay, we need to outreach to Asian workers, like it doesn't, you can just have like, oh, here's one person can go out and do outreach, right? That's just not possible. It's just going to be like, okay, you're going to be able to do outreach to Chinese-speaking, right, workers or Korean-speaking workers, right? It's not. So it's extremely challenging. It's extremely challenging. But the way that we do address it at the organization is that our staff, so we have a pretty small staff, but we speak 8 different languages. Right, and so that's something that's vital to us, right, and something that is like, that is a job qualification. You must be able to speak another language and have it mirror, right, the population working in the industry. But it's really challenging because then meetings run for like 3 hours, right, because you're trying to translate and interpret everything. But when you see it like work, you have like Spanish-speaking workers and French-speaking workers, from primarily from West Africa to Chinese-speaking workers coming together. When that all comes together, I mean, it's challenging. When it comes together, it's all worth it. It's all worth it, but it's very, very challenging.
The other thing that I worry a lot about as an artist is the things that get lost in translation are like. As hard as I try to make appropriate translation and consult with Colombian speakers, with the Spanish, the Mexican Spanish speakers, and so on, I always get really scared of when the essence of what someone is trying to say is lost in that translation. So that's what I always struggle with that, like trying to like really wanting to honor what that person said, and then being really scared that I didn't do it correctly.
Yeah. I think there was a little bit of slippage. Sunday morning with that, we had Nicaragua and other ladies from Mexico.
You're right. thanks for the presentation and discussion. I on that translation and language. I was thinking about the significance of the, I really like this, the repetitive body actions that were happening in your performances and the work. And something I'm involved in at the moment is a project called Manual Labor, about physical and emotional relationships to work, and we're also kind of thinking through those repetitious habits the bodies get into at work, and how if we draw attention to them, we could potentially, there might be some agency and power in that drawing attention and sharing and watching how other people are working, or your co-workers' bodies are moving and mirroring them, and maybe potentially taking that into public spaces as well and inviting others to get involved. So I think there's these really interesting things that the bodies can do in terms of communication beyond language. So that was that sort of area. Maybe if there's time for any sort of comments or reflections as well on when you've been doing those, what's come out of that and how that's felt. And maybe I just kind of on the little thing to have on the end, in my naive sort of naivety from a British context, I was wondering about the ROC and the relationship to unionising, because I work in a trade union and know the kind of difficulty of organising fragmented workforce, but also the power one has as a trade union member, recognised trade union member with collective bargaining powers, that the thing you have in common and the powerful thing you have is that you can withdraw your labour, and that's how you want to speak. Hopefully, make some differences. And I wonder what your experiences of withdrawing labour collectively has been in the industries, in the restaurant trade.
Sure. So, you know, that's a question that, you know, that I definitely get a lot. I think there's a tremendous challenge, right? Because, as you said, you know, it is a very fragmented industry. You know, workers. You know, we have a joke that isn't really funny, but that, you know, a lot of, you know, internally at ROC and our members kind of share, we always talk about like, oh, you know, the only mobility that exists in this industry is worker going from one job, one restaurant to another restaurant, to another, right? So like it's kind of, so that's a challenge too, right? Where workers are not staying, right? They're continuously moving, seeking, you know, better opportunities. And so, you know, for us is, you know, how can we, you know, in light of, you know, those challenges, right? And right now there isn't, you know, necessarily a lot of organizing, right, in terms of union, labor union organizing, right, in this particular sector. But for us it's like, well, you know, if labor union organizing isn't happening, well, what are other ways that we can organize so that people can at least be able to, you know, enforce their rights, right, on the job? How can we bring people together to be able to, you know, remedy violations of law? So we're really looking at like, well, how can we fill this gap right now that exists, and at least be able to move changes in different ways, you know, not just in terms of having collective bargaining agreements, but you know, how are other, what other forms can exist in this vacuum?
That was a great question. You just made me reflect on kind of the evolution of the practice. Because we started off doing these, you know, these performances of the scores and the script, and there are moments, especially with the scores, where we would have like a group of five people enter the performance space, right, and it was just beautiful to watch the cacophony of movement and voices and all of that happening at the same time. And then kinds of reflections that we would get back is, because we, again, a lot of times working in the community college sector with those people as an audience, and those people really coming from working class backgrounds, is then during the reflective space, getting a lot of comments about people's mother or fathers having spent 20 to 30 years in the restaurant industry, or they themselves working in a fast food environment, and then us then being able to use that moment to then connect them to ROC or to have a deeper conversation about what it means to work in the restaurant industry. And then now it's like that's performing it, and now we're like at Open Engagement, we're just instead of performing the worker action, we're doing it, So it'll be really interesting for us to see, like if that provides more of an experiential kind of like depth for people, and I don't know, how much longer does that stay with you when you're pretending versus when you're actually doing it.
I'd like to invite everybody to stay and have a glass of wine and some snacks. And I'd like to thank our wonderful speakers for taking the time with us this evening. We really appreciate your perspectives, and I hope that everybody will take the opportunity to get to know each other a little bit.